So they let me do that, and somehow Beth heard about that, and here I am. So I am here to ramble at you. There is a list on your handout of some of the likely topics. If any of you has a favorite that you'd really like to hear about, call it out now and I'll try to get to it, because there's no way I can tell all these great stories in the time that we have. So look quickly, and while you're looking, I'm going to tell you a very quick story that people always want to know more about. So I was talking about doing German history, and mentioned something that I thought everybody knew and they didn't, so let me make sure that you know. How many of you have German ancestry? Yes, most of us tend to have that. This is Europe in 1709, and you can see that Germany was broken up into many little duchies and many kingdoms that were perfect for making musicals. and many of our modern Hallmark films for ladies that take place in these various locations. But as you can see, that there was much warfare that was going on. They could not unify, so they were constantly at risk for various things. Life was not very easy because of that lack of unity. Well, along comes 1700s, and the last of the Habsburgs monarchs, King Charles of Spain, died without an heir. Now, this is not a good plan. Please be sure that you have prepared better than he did. Because in his will, he left the entire Spanish Empire at that time, which consisted of the Netherlands, Luxembourg, Naples, Milan, Spain, and all the colonies in the New World and his Pacific colonies, he left them to his grandson, who was Louis XIV of France. Okay, so Spain just gave everything to France, and this did not go over well with quite a few people. Nonetheless, in 1707, France advanced across the Rhine into Germany to go pick up some more things because they were there for the picking and they were small and couldn't fight back very well. In 1709, Louis XIV was negotiating an end to the war because they had drained all their resources in defense of these Spanish possessions that they never had before, but he lost everything in the treasury, trying to keep it, and he lost all of his military gains for the 30 years prior to that. France decided that he'd better go back to war because the negotiations weren't going too well, and he had to try to come up with a better result. Eventually, in 1712, we have the Treaty of Utrecht, where the Louis XIV and Philip V of Spain agreed that France and Spain would never be united under one crown, but the Habsburgs refused to sign. Wars just kept going on and on. In 1714, that war ended, but it was not the end to war everywhere. Now, as you can imagine, with all of this back and forth, Spain to France to Germany to France to Spain, anybody who was in the way was toppled over. Their properties, their food, their women, their munitions, everything that they had was taken by opposing armies on both sides. And those who were farmers were unable to farm because of the circumstances. It wasn't safe to be out in the field at all. So there was a great deal of famine from all these wars that were going on. We also had a lot of environmental problems at the time. There was a drought. Things just got worse and worse in Europe. Now, those who were most affected were those who were en route. And these were the people that we know as the Palatines. Now, how many of you have Palatines as your ancestors? Yes, you know that, I'm sure. There are some very interesting first-hand accounts of what it was like. The first city they took was Spire, a noble, flourishing town, and instantly put it under contribution. That means they took everything they wanted. ordering also 6,000 men and demanding 60,000 crowns of the inhabitants under pain of burning it to the ground. They reduced themselves almost to beggary to pay this sum, which the baron had no sooner received, but he caused proclamation to be made with sound of trumpet that the people should all retire with their goods because the town was to be burned, and so on. This was the manner of war. This was the manner in which the Palatines were being treated. And they did reduce town after town to ashes. It was not a good place to live, and the Palatines had nowhere to go in their own country. Those who had any resources left hoped to flee down the Rhine River to get out of the country. That was the quickest way out. But to do so, they had to have funds to pay off a ship captain to take them on board and to pay for various people who kind of stopped them along the way and demanded some loot in order to let the boat proceed. It was a dangerous, difficult thing. And these people were already starving. They were already ill. They had very terrible circumstances. And when they finally got to the border, they wanted to get across into Rotterdam out of Germany, and Rotterdam would not let them in because they were all sick, they were all impoverished, they were desperate, and they did not speak the same language, although you'd think they might have, they didn't. And they would not let them in. So refugees piled up, and they became more impoverished, more sick, more starving, no resources. It was a terrible circumstance. Now, seeing this, Queen Anne of England, who was German by ancestry, had much empathy for what was going on, and she wanted to help. She negotiated with the Netherlands, said, if you will let them through, I promise to bring them out. And she paid out of her personal funds, rather than English treasury funds, she paid for ships, 13 ships, to bring across as many as she could right then and there. And so it was that thousands and thousands of these refugees fleeing from the desolation in Europe ended up on the streets of London in a little bitty park and square where they set up a tent city. And there they were, starving, still ill, still having no resources except for what the queen could send over every now and then. Well, at the same time, there were others who were seeking the good graces of Queen Anne. They had come over from North America. They were among the greatest diplomats of the world. They were hired frequently by crowned heads of Europe. Everybody knew that those who were Mohawk and Iroquois were incredibly talented in linguistics. They could pick up a language just the like of that. They really had a way with words, and they could speak in almost any language. And so many of these interpreters and diplomats were hired by the court of England to try to make nice better than those in Europe were making nice, because they weren't. So at this time, there were Mohawk diplomats who were in the court. They were actually there to negotiate with Queen Anne about the problems they were having between the French and English. You remember the French and Indian War. They were over there to discuss these problems and where did the Queen stand on various things. And they saw that.
I just wondered, what year is it that Queen Anne did the ships?
1709.
Thank you.
Queen Anne was asked, who are these pathetic people? What has happened to your tribe? What is going on? We don't understand. Now, at first, when the people came, Londoners were sympathetic, but pretty soon, there wasn't enough bread. There wasn't enough food. There was crime. There was illness spreading from this little tent city, and the Londoners had enough of this. And there were attacks on the refugees. What is this terrible situation, the Mohawks wanted to know. And Queen Anne explained, they have no place to go. And on our little island, we have no place to take them. And the Mohawk diplomat said, there is much land where we come from. If we can get them there, they are welcome, and we will give them a goodly land for them to live on and be safe. Queen Anne took them up on this generous offer, and again, out of her personal funds, she had 10 large vessels built and sent over 7,000 of these migrants immediately. She got them over and arranged with them that they would take advantage of the forests. You know, the forests of North America was the source of all the masts for the vast shipping. You know, this was a maritime era, and they needed very straight, perfect trunks for not only the masts, but the spars and so on. And these were the ideal strong hardwoods that were in those forests. We chopped down most of our trees in North America for sake of the wars in Europe. But we also had tar and hemp to make rope. And she arranged for them to help pay back the costs of getting them over there and building these ships by having them, you know, pry hemp and tar and so on for the British. And they did. They set up a vibrant industry. And Germans are very hard workers and very honest in their personal dealings, and they really appreciated what the Queen had done. And so they began to come down the river here to get into Rotterdam and come across. And here's dear Queen Anne. The first batch that she brought over was the 3,000 that came into London, and soon it had risen to 14,000, and it just wasn't going to work. Now, the records of these are recorded in German documents, which you can find online, and if any of you read Fractured, you know, more power to you, but you can read the original accounts of this. This is the land that the Mohawks chose for them. It's a beautiful place where three rivers come together, and they were able to build canals alongside the river and build up a vibrant trade. This was the beginning of the German migration to the Americas. First story, okay.
Wow.
Where did they land?
They landed them first in the New York area and at New York Harbor, and then took them upriver to the confluence of those three rivers farther inland, much farther inland. The Iroquois Nation, as you probably know, occupied much of what we now call New York, going up toward the lakes. So they headed inland up the river and settled there.
Up the Hudson.
The Hudson, Mohawk, and Skamari. So right there in that beautiful valley. Yes, sir.
Before you go forward, I just wanted to make sure I understood it. Now, the Mohawk and the Iroquois, were they diplomats sit by someone or by themselves?
They came representing themselves.
Okay.
To negotiate with Queen Anne about problems they were having during the French and Indian War. There was, you know, trouble with the French. There was, you know, Canada, or, you know, up there, and the British had control over much of Canada, but not all of it at that point. And they had come to discuss the situation with Queen Anne. So it was while they were there in her court that they observed the situation. The Iroquois and Mohawk diplomats were hired by various courts in Europe on a fairly regular basis.
An important note that I heard when you were saying it, they showed compassion out of human kindness, even though what you just told us, that they was in a kind of like a war. Their land being probably taken, or, you know, And that's just amazing. They show human kindness under those, you know, dealing with what they're dealing with.
That's right.
And I understand, you know, Anne had compassion for her ancestry roots, but that's really Christ-like inside of life.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
That's a story worth knowing, I think, about those who were native inhabitants here. Yes?
I'd like you to not miss the Year Without a Summer. Because I had one of those in New England myself.
Okay, I didn't make slides of that, but let me just give you a quickie on the Year Without a Summer. In 1816, the volcano over in the Indonesian area, Tambora, exploded. This is like having Yellowstone blow up, which we're expecting any minute now. But Tambora exploded, and it was one of the largest in historical times that we know of. The result of this explosion was to spread an ash cloud that circled the globe, and it was so strong, so heavy, so thick, that for years afterwards, there was this haze that covered a wind belt of the world, resulting from this eruption. Now, in Europe, we already had lots of drought going on, and now we had a land that was covered with ice. The rivers in England froze over. The fields froze over. In Europe, fields froze and crops were ruined. Likewise, in New England, we had the same situation. So we have what was called the Year Without a Summer. Between about April and July of 1816, there were chunks of ice covering the rivers in the middle of the summer. The crops froze, and nothing could be raised. It ruined all the crops. Now you remember that time period, this is, you know, right after the War of 1812. This was also a time period where there was a great deal of migration from New England across to the Western Reserve, which had just really opened. And people began moving out to Ohio, Iowa, Indiana, and so on. They moved because their farms were dead, and they had to walk away. There was no way to survive, and they weren't going to stay for another season. Some stayed for a couple of seasons. They started to see the effects of Tambora soon after its explosion, which was in 1815, but the Year Without a Summer was 1816. And it was just a terrible time. No one could raise anything. So many farmers failed, and they left New England. So you have mass migration to the west, which was warmer and lower elevation. And the farmers moved out of New England after the Year Without a Summer.
Did that apply also to Virginia?
Yes, although only the northern portions were having snows in July in Virginia. It was heavier up north, and the farther south you came, the more normal it was. So yes, the northern half of Virginia was also affected, but not as badly as part of the north. Even Pennsylvania had a lot of troubles. It was a hard time environment.
Basically, you answered it. I was going to ask about the Carolinas, like South Carolina.
Not so much. Okay. Very, very little seen there.
Okay.
Very little. Okay. How many of you were raised in California? Really? Ooh, good. Sometimes when I ask, there'll be like two or three. Most everybody, you know, has come from someplace else. So those of you who are raised here, you pretty much know the stories. You grew up on making little models of the missions. You all made a mission model, or your parents made a mission model for you, and you made it. Those of you who don't know, California was initially settled from European stock. We had about 300,000 indigenous people here when the Spaniards arrived from down in Mexico, New Spain, as they called it then. They began the very difficult, challenging effort of trying to build missions along the coastline coming up north. I'm not going to take time to tell you the stories of the missions. They're fun too, but I do want to tell you a little part of that story that you may not have heard. It bugs the heck out of me. We don't tell all the story. You know, we tell such selective bits of stories. I want you to know about a man who probably had more impact on the history of California than any other human being, and I'm sure there's not one person in this room who even recognizes the name, Antonio Bucarelli. I want you to know and respect this man. Antonio Bucarelli might be considered the George Washington of his day. He was an extraordinarily honorable and good man. So much so that when he died, the King of Spain ordered that there was to be no audit whatsoever of his work and the treasury over which he held sway, because he was too honorable a man to even question. He was loaned $2.5 million, multiply that by 16 to get the equivalent in those days, $2.5 million from merchants for a project where he needed the money on his honor only, with no collateral and no paperwork signed. This is a very unusual man. This man, as you can see from the emblem here and displayed on his chest at all times, this man was of the Order of the Knights Templar. And I'd love to tell you those stories, but I can't tell you the stories in the emblem. So go home and read about the Knights Templar, who had obviously been out in the Crusades and came back, and they were among the nicer guys of those who were Crusaders. They set up hospitals and took care of the poor wherever they were. They are known mostly for that, for their humanitarian kindness wherever they went, for the free hospitals that they set up, and for the enormous treasure that they somehow managed to acquire in order to accomplish these things and to maintain these hospitals. And those of you who have seen National Treasure, that enormous room full of gold and whatnot at the end, that's from the Knights Templar. That was the Knights Templar of the treasure. They were kindly, they were exceedingly Christian in the better sense of the word, that they reached out to everyone, and it did not matter if you were Muslim or Hindu, it didn't matter who you were, if you needed care, they would take you in and make sure that you would be healed in their hospitals. They were very, very fine. Well, Bucarelli was such a man. He had enormous talent and genius for organization, but he did not have an ambitious blood vessel anywhere. He entirely wanted to do his best. And that was his ambition. And to do it in a manner befitting a Knight Templar. Antonio Bucarelli, for various things I'm not going into, he had been made governor of Cuba early on, but eventually he was tasked by the King of Spain to be the viceroy of New Spain, there was another viceroy down here in South America, but he was in charge of, in European terms, and Nueva California, or Alta California as we know it. This was under his administration. And we hear about the stories of the Portola and Perez and Seta and, you know, all the early Spanish explorers that were working up to find what was available on the northwest Pacific coast. We hear about those stories, but we don't ever hear about the man who made it possible for them to do these things. My husband was a logistician, and there's an awful lot that goes into putting together one of these things and making it possible and having the foresight to have things in place so you don't just send people out there and think, well, good luck, let us know, send us a postcard. You know, we really like to know how things are, take selfies, you know. There was nothing that was available to a European-raised person who did not know how to live off the land or where to go, or, you know, there weren't farms and so on along the Pacific coast. So they were coming into a land where there wouldn't be anything except what they brought and what could be resupplied. Go home and reread all the stories about, you know, how they founded the missions. But let me just bring to your mind some of the difficulties that they would have. Now, Mexico City is about 1,800 miles from San Francisco, from where we are more or less. And that's a long way. You know, that's like two-thirds of the way across the U.S. East-West. And between Mexico City, which is way, way, way over there, between there and San Diego, which was the first mission, as you may recall, and all those going north up to Monterey and so on, between there was mostly deserts. And some of the very, very treacherous waters. The Gulf of California is known for its horrific storms, and you'd think you'd think that's fairly sheltered, how come? But that's an interesting thing too, but we can't talk about the winds anyway. anyway, they're tremendous storms. They had a great deal of difficulty in sending ships from Mexico out the Pacific Way to get past the Baja Peninsula, which had four deserts and was separated from Alta California also by the Colorado River. And if you think of the Colorado River in that area, what are we looking at? What's there? We've got, think Grand Canyon on, and those deep canyons. You know, not easy to take a wagon across that and let them drive the cattle. You know, so this is a very hard thing. And there are four separate deserts. There were quite a few indigenous nations that were in between. And of course, they weren't particularly in favor of anybody else taking resources. They hadn't had that much experience with Europeans to this point, so they didn't know how relationships would go, but there's only so much resource to go around, and what is it you're doing, and who are you people? Now, in San Blas, which is down here, San Blas is one of the few places that they were actually able to build up as a port. Think of this, as kind of virgin territory as far as what Europeans would do, ports and cities and that sort of thing. They had salt mines there, and of course we desperately needed salt for everything. So this was a good thing. This was a reason to be here in this new land, in the new world. And the salt mines would bring in about 25,000 pesos annually, but it cost 250,000 pesos, pardon the dollar bill, pesos to just barely keep the missions of California running, just the mission. So it, this is not a paying proposition. The missions were not producing enough to keep themselves running, and they certainly weren't providing resources to the crown. The only other thing that they found out here on the west coast of Nueva España was that there were some pearl beds, but they couldn't get anybody who was able to get them. The pearls were too deep and they were in dangerous waters. So although they knew that there were pearls, they only got a little of what was available there. So, okay, Bucarelli, we want you to be the viceroy, to stand for the royalty. We want you to be the voice of the king for this vast continent, at least the western half of it. You need to make it worth our while. And you need to make sure that nobody else comes in and makes it worth their while. So you must keep everybody else out, and you must find a way to make the crown rich from this. I'm going to send Bucarelli. He can do impossible things, he'll be honest about it, and we'll see how it goes. God seems to be on his side. Okay, so, just a quickie reminder of history. I'm sorry to do that. 1769, the Franciscans, we have Jesuits, the Franciscans, and the Dominicans were all involved in trying to settle Baja California, the peninsula. At this point, the Franciscans were like to, the three denominations were all fighting, and there was a lot of competition between them, and some fairly nasty stuff that went back and forth. But the Franciscans went with Portola to establish the missions in Alta California. The Jesuits particularly had been down in Baja California. Now we're going to try to found missions in Alta California. Now the direct sea route from San Blas, where the salt mines are, down there at the end of the peninsula, the direct sea route from San Blas to San Diego takes about 68 days. Well, that doesn't seem so terrible, except then it was. Because at that point, Spain and most of the rest of the world had no idea how to stave off scurvy. They had no idea. You know, the Brits were called limeys because they knew that secret. They knew that citrus, and what was in potatoes, and various vegetables would keep you from getting scurvy. Having terrible, terrible pain, losing your teeth, having enormous sores, and simply dying. Scurvy was a horror, and once you had it, unless you could land at an island and get some food that provided greens and citrus and the like, or unless you were a Brit and you knew what to do and were prepared, you were going to die. Scurvy was a horrifying thing. And there was no way to get from San Blas to San Diego 68 days without getting scurvy. You need the nutrition sooner than that. It was tough. And it was stormy. It's a nasty place for sailing. 1771 alone in the Gulf of California, five ships that they sent out were just straight out sunk in storms. One was blown by a storm as far south as Panama, and it took them 6 months to be blown down there and get back. So doing a settlement of Alta California was going to be a major challenge. It was not going to be easy, however you did this. Baja California couldn't farm diddly, it's all deserts and whatnot. So they could not supply the provisions that were needed for setting up missions in Alta California. The Jesuits got into some trouble there, and they were expelled, and the Dominicans and the Franciscans dealt with it, and the Franciscans were going to take the north. And they're trying to figure out what to do. We need to get up there. We need to secure this because we know that the Russians are coming from the north. The Russians had been, going sealing and Otterburg and whatnot was all the rage in Europe. It was an enormous economic benefit to the Tsar, and the Russians had come down as far as our Fort Ross, as you know, and they were farming as they came down in order to supply the needs of the whalers at all farther up in Alaska. So we knew that that the Russians were, really doing well, and they were setting up a considerable communities, and they set up a shipyard. They were building ships and repairing ships down here in Fort Ross, and they were in San Francisco Bay. We have a real risk here because now the British and the French are out there, and they're also looking for more places to be. They're exploring, and the King of Spain did not want to lose everything, because this, of course, is just following the height of the Manila Galleon era. So the tremendous riches of China and the rest of the East had been coming across on those annual Manila Galleons. They would come into Acapulco and San Blas and then be carted across Mexico to Veracruz and on to Europe. And the silks that end up in Spain were tremendous riches. This was, aside from the gold that they were stealing from farther south, the silks from China and the porcelains were a tremendous source of wealth in Europe. So the king certainly did not want to lose any of this. This was important to do something, but how? I mean, they really were trying, but how? So 1773, Father Serra, he'd gone up in 69, and they'd been trying to get things going with Portola, but in 73, Father Serra wrote back to Bucarelli that it would take 1,500 mules and 100 muleteers per year to bring in enough food for the missions. They were trying to have, little truck gardens beside the mission to support themselves, but what do you do till the thing grows? And you also have to deal with the soldiers that have come along and so on. And the whole point is to encourage the native people and give them gifts. And the mission gave away so much food that they were starving. So it just wasn't going well at all. In fact, it was going so badly that Bucarelli wrote the king and told him that it might soon be necessary to abandon Alta California entirely. Okay, so Alta California, y'all know what we're talking about. We're talking about, U.S. and up today, is that Father Serra had been working with his soldiers, and Portola and other explorers had risked everything multiple times with very courageous, great stories there. And they were finding it impossible to find a route where you could get food or water for that many mules. There just wasn't a route. Coming across the Great Plains, we would simply wait for May. The rains had come, they'd grown the grasses, okay, on your mark, get set, go, and all the wagons would come across during the wagon season. And then, when it dried out, that's it for travel for the year. Well, there wasn't a season and there wasn't a place. They could not find a way to get through. So what they were searching for was that. Not only that, but they lacked the pack animals. They didn't have the mules. They tried to import them from Spain. They are importing mules. Now think of the ships trying to bring the mules over for this purpose. San Blas is harbor, and it kept filling in, and the ships would run aground at San Blas. So you couldn't bring them around Cape Horn, or I imagine your shipload of mules coming around Cape Horn. You can't bring them into San Blas, which is the only port that we have at this point. There were very few ships on the west coast in the first place. You know, who's building ships over there besides the Russians? They had to send to Spain for all their tools and iron, for all manufactured goods, their canvas, the tackle for the ships, the artillery. So it would take about 2 years from the time that you sent the request to the time that you got a delivery if it was approved. The soldiers had to force sailors on board a ship because, as far as they were concerned, it was a death sentence. They were going to die of scurvy or go down in a storm. They couldn't get anybody to get off.
Excuse me, Kathy, I need to change.
Oh, there's another group coming in, so we had to clear out right away. Sorry.
Thank you.